So hello and greetings to the all the viewers. Today we will going to learn thermal analysis of shell and tube type heat exchanger using ANSYS workbench. So in this video I will going to present how to do thermal analysis, how to apply various thermal loads as well as how to define the different material definitions which is required for thermal analysis, and then how to see the results like thermal gradient across the various components of heat exchanger. So we will start now. So this slide represent the learnings in this video. First we will see the small introduction to shell and tube type heat exchanger. Then we will see the construction as well as workflow of heat exchanger. And then we will move towards our actual ANSYS learning. So there we will see how to define the materials which are required for to perform the thermal simulation. Then we will see how to apply the thermal loads, and then we will further see the perfectly insulation's loading condition, how to apply that respective convection coefficient, and then we will extract the result, and we will try to see the temperature gradient across the various component of shell and tube type heat exchanger. So this slide represents the small introduction to shell and tube type heat exchangers. As the name suggests, these are like most widespread and commonly used basic heat exchanger configuration in the process industry due to its advantages like large ratio of heat transfer area to volume as well as weight, easy to construct and clean, and mechanical rug not withstand fabrication. These are mainly subjected to pressure as well as temperature gradient at the shell and tube side regions. Also cyclic loads may occur due to switch on and the switch off of the fluid inside the heat exchanger. So this is what the schematic of shell and tube type heat exchangers. We will see the more construction of this in next slide so that we will get some idea. So if you see, this schematic represent the shell and tube type heat exchanger. This outer portion is nothing but your shell, and these are the heads, right? And if you see, these are the tubes, and this is tube sheet, and these are the nozzles, and the base is nothing but your saddle. So these are the major components of any heat exchangers, like tube sheet, your shell, and the nozzles from where the fluid will come into picture. So when we talk about shell and tube type heat exchanger, there are two things will come into picture: tube side as well as shell side. The tube side is nothing but the side in which the tube side flow will going to flow. Suppose there will be one more nozzle will going to be here, and from that nozzle the fluid will come into this region and it will go inside the tubes and then it will come out from this. So this region where the fluid will come into picture, this region is nothing but your tube side region, and the shell side region is nothing but the fluid which will moving over the tubes. You can see from this like this. Here you can see that these are the baffles which allows to make maximize the heat transfer area. Okay, so there might be different duty cycles. One of the duty cycle when the equipment will going to start, and when equipment going to shut down. So in this kind of shell and tube type heat exchangers, these are basically subjected to thermal as well as pressure loads may have possibility to cause the thermal fatigue, because it is subjected to different duty cycles which are having at high temperature regions, as well as some structural failure which will going to come. And most of the stresses are developed at this tube to tube sheet junction, this junction, as well as tube to tube sheet and tube to shell junction, because here you will find the more temperature gradient, also some of the failures at the saddle support, because here we will going to fix. Okay, so these are the loading conditions in this. So if you see, first the shell side and tube side temperature at the start and at the steady state conditions. So they wanted here we need to simulate the temperature behavior at the start of the heat exchanger, as well as once yours after an hour you will get some steady state condition. So that condition also we need to simulate. then the condition like outer surface is perfectly insulated and also having atmospheric temperature of 22. So this tabular section represent the first cloud case, that is your start of the cycle. The shell side will be 260 and tube side will be 22. And here like once steady state is over, this 260 will going to reduce up to 200 and this 22 degree centigrade will going to increase up to 120 degree centigrade. So if you see here, so here at the start of the cycle, here it is like 260 degree centigrade. And at the start of cycle, it will be like 22 degree centigrade. So once equipment will start running, after an hour, you will find this temperature of shell side, which is at 260, it will going to reduce up to 200. And this will going to increase up to 120. So this is due to the heat transfer, which will going to happen between shell side and tube side. Okay. Then we will move towards our actual simulation part in ANSYS. There we will try to simulate these conditions. So now we will move towards our actual ANSYS part. Before proceeding to this, you just cross check with the unit first and this drag and drop your steady state thermal module. Once it is open, you just go to geometry editor and you can read the geometry from your local directory, like from file import external geometry file. And then give the path of that respective geometry. Okay, so this is the model which I actually created in Design Modeler itself. If you also want to create, you just refer my another video which explains about how to create vertical pressure vessel using ANSYS Design Modeler. So there you will get some idea how to create this much when this kind of geometry will be there. Okay. So this geometry, as we discussed earlier, it may consist of your head. This is what your shell, this is your nozzle, and which are supported by using these saddles. Okay. And these are the baffles and these are the your tubes from which your fluid will going to flow. Okay. And as we discuss regarding shell side and tube side, the shell side fluid will be, we will discuss that in mechanical window. Here like this is what your complete solid model, and I had created this saddle using shell model just to reduce the mesh count. Okay, you can do also at your handle. Even here also it is possible to extract the shell for a complete vessel also, but there you will not able to find the gradient. So that's why it is mandatory you can go with the solid elements when you will going to do the thermal solutions and you want to see the temperature gradient across the thicknesses. Okay, once it is done, you just create different parts for your solid bodies, and as these are like shell bodies and different parts are your solid bodies, shell and different parts for your solid. Okay, now we will move towards once it is done your geometry cleanup and all the settings, you just quickly move towards your mechanical window, right? So here you will find that geometric definitions, and here also you can find this is shell part. Okay, now before proceeding to that, first we need to cross check with the connections. So here this is the single part, so there is no need to define any connection, but here it is different part. So you can define a connection between saddle and shell. Okay, so here right click, insert, manual contact region, select these two different surfaces. Here no need to worry about shell and tube side, because that will not going to create much more impact, and this is not your non-linear simulation, this is straightly linear and which is very much straightforward. So no need to worry about your shell side, contact and target definition in contact. Okay, once your contact is done, you just define your meshing, create your mesh. Here actually I did some coarse mesh because just to get the faster solutions. At your end, you just go through at least three elements across the thickness, and also if it is possible, you just keep two elements across these tubes, right? And once your meshing is done, you can move towards your actual loading condition. But before loading condition, you just make sure that your material definition, right now it is by default structural steel. So what I will do, I will create a material definition. You just go to engineering data. So when you do you are doing any thermal simulation, so there are like important thing that you need to define the thermal conductivity, which is very much important. You can see here, this is by default your structural steel material, and here you will find the thermal conductivity, which is like 60.5 watt per meter Kelvin, mag per meter degree centigrade. You can see, right? So that is very much important when you will going to do the thermal simulation. So how you can define that, I will tell you. You just go here, put structural steel, right? It is already there, that's why it is not coming. So Control C, Control V, I will write SS, right? And here you can see here thermal definition. So you can define here like 60.2 or whatever it may be, like that you can define your structural steel. There is one, when you will couple this structure thermal simulation with structural, then you will find there more definition of material. So there we need to define your Young's modulus, then we need to define Poisson's ratio, and then we need to define the thermal expansion coefficient. And also, if suppose you are doing transient thermal, so in that case we also need to define the specific heat. Okay, so if you have different material details like different thermal conductivity in different direction, in case of orthotropic, you can define from this also. But I had seen like most of the customer, or you can say the most of the equipments lie under the isotropic thermal conductivity. So this is what your assumptions. Okay, so once your material is defined, you just quickly move towards your mechanical window. I will not update this because it will take time. So once it is done, the very first thing that you just create a name selection for your shell side and tube side, because if you see our temperature definitions are like that. So I will create the name selection first. I will select the what is the tube side region, so that you will also come to know. I will select all these parts. I will keep extend to limit. Okay, and I will select all the inside tubes region, because the fluid which will come in tube side will move under this tubes and will flow from this side to that side. Okay, once it is done, you just further do extend to limit. So you will find all the internal surfaces are selected. Further do extend to limit. Okay, so this is my tube side region. Insert, create name selection, put here tube side region. Okay, similarly you can create a shell side region. So shell side will be above the tubes. I think here we had missed something. I will suppress which already created. I will these are already created. I will just delete that. And this is what your tube side region. And here I think we had need to select these faces also. Extend to limit. Actually this complete heat exchanger is with the full of this, but here we have taken the half symmetry. So this is tube side region, and later on we will consider the shell side region. I will not going to consider this baffles, because I just wanted to tell you what is the effect of this baffle. Later on we will see in the next video, there I will going to do the simulation, static structural plus thermal. So there you will come to know the difference. The purpose of this baffle just to create the supports for this, and also create the your shell side fluid should move like this, so that you will get the maximum surface area. Now I will select the tube shell side region. I will do extend to limit. I will select this face. I will select this place, and I will also select all the remaining top faces. outer surface of the my tubes. Here you can use extend to limit option, and this half portion also you can use. There are few tubes are missing still. You just thoroughly cross check is there any pipe or tubes are missing. Extend to limit, I think all tubes are selected. So this is my shell side reason, because shell side fluid will going to move on this. Okay, now here we haven't considered the complete vessel. We consider the half symmetry. So for that you just go to symmetry condition, right click insert symmetry, and here insert symmetry region. So here you can define the symmetry region. So I will going to select all these faces. All the half portion you need to select in the symmetry region, as well as I will going to select these faces. Even I will going to select these edges also. Insert symmetry region. So there you can define these edges. So I will going to do extend to limit here, apply. Okay, so here it is done. Symmetry is, you need to define, keep in mind, just go to model, right click and do this, define your symmetry condition. Now our next phase will come, your loading condition. So I will going to put the temperature. Here I will going to put temperature on a shell side. So here name selection, you can tube side first you can define. So there are two loading conditions. So I will going to put here two loading conditions, these are already there. And first temperature, we know that first will be here, you can define the your atmospheric temperature, that is 22. And the temperature on tube side first will be, first load case it will be 22, and then later on it will going to increase in second load test to 120. Now similarly I will going to further define temperature. I will keep here now shell side. So first it will be on 260 at the start of the cycle, and later on it will reduce to 200. Okay, so like that you can define the temperature. Once it is done, right, now the next loading condition is like it is perfectly insulated. So there will be insulation on the top of this, on the outer surface of this vessel. So what I will do, insert here, one option is given, that is perfectly insulated. So you can use that option. This is by auto default, you will come to know. Once you will do this, even you can select this nozzle outer surface says apply. And here one thing will come, your in this is subjected to atmospheric condition. So what I will do, I will define there convection. And what I will do here, if you see there are few conditions are defined already in the ANSYS. So like stagnant air, horizontal cylinder, stagnant air simplify case, vertical planes. So like that, if you want this, I will pick this. By default it will give you from 1 degree to 1000 degree centigrade, whatever the your watt per meters mm square degree centigrade convection coefficient. So I will select all the faces, apply, right. So here what I am saying, natural convection will going to happen in this case, because that is facing the atmosphere. So this is the condition. So So now we had defined the thermal loads, that is in two load gains distance. If you see, I will show you further our table. So the first load case like 260, and second load case it will reduce to 200 and 22 to 120. So we know that it is like that only, right? 260 to 200. So your loads are defined. So first you had defined material, then you defined your symmetry condition, and then your context details are done, then meshing is done, and then your different name selection for the loadings and boundary conditions. Okay, once it is done, you just right click and solve. So whatever the loads are there, you just define like this. It will take some time. My mesh count is like quite coarser, that's why we are able to solve that within a short period of time. In actual, it will take like half an hour of time based on your configurations. Okay, but it is, at least you should take 2 to 3 elements across the thickness just to capture the bending behavior. When you will going to do for thermal simulation, there is no need of making concentration of meshing, but when you will going to do structural simulation, there is a need. Okay, now we will extract the results. Evaluate all the results. So if you see here, our thermal results are done, and there are like two different load cases. What I will do, I will put display time 1 for one load case, and I will duplicate that, and I will put display time 2. So we will come to know what is the temperature for load case 1 and as well as for load case 2. So if you see here, for a load case 1, I am getting the temperature of this is due to the contact definition. I will put here 22, right? Minimum it will be like this. So this is at this, which is localized, and maximum it will be 260. So what we will see, we will see the reason. I will display this reason, right? And here if you probe, you will come to know it is 260 here, and gradually it is reducing. You can see here it is 22. So like that, we will get the gradient across this. Even at, this is perfectly insulated, so that's why there is no temperature loss. But here it is, your tube side is at 20 degree centigrade and your shell side is at 260 degree centigrade. Okay, similarly here also you can see the temperature gradient. It is like from atmospheric, this is we had kept it at the atmospheric, so the due to the conduction you will find the temperature is reducing up to 110 degree centigrade. So if you have even testing results, or you can say actual field results which you had measured by using thermocouple, so you can also apply like that. This is the worst case scenario, right? So this is the temperature output for load case 1, where we had applied from 22 atmospheric to 260 degree centigrade, and the same we are getting. And similarly for load case 2, right? Load case 2 we are getting from 120 to 200, and similarly we are getting here also gradient. So we will check that further. Here it is 200, right? So 200 to 120, you can see here. Here also we will further cross check. It is like 2. So shell side to tube side, here if you see the temperature gradient is less in this case compared to earlier. In earlier case it is like from 260 to our atmospheric temperature, that is 22. So here it is less, and you can see here inside the tubes also, as we tube side fluid, here it is 120, but here if you see outside this tube it is 200. Inside the tube you will find 120. Okay, and here also you can see the gradient 200 to 76. Okay, so like that we need to do the thermal simulations. If you have proper results or if your temperature measurement which you had done at your field, then based from the thermocouples you can apply that respective temperature at your different tube and shell side and you can do the thermal simulations. Okay, so that's it. Like that you can do thermal simulation for different configurations of pressure vessels as well as your heat exchangers. I will continue this video in next there we will see what are the results, or you can say what are the thermal stresses for these two configuration at the start of the cycle and at the end of the cycle. If I will continue now, then you will find that there will be huge time. Already it is like half an hour, but what I will do, I will split into two parts. First part will be your thermal simulation and second part will be static simulations. Okay guys, so thank you for your time and keeping patient for watching this complete video. Let me know your comments, I will be there to help you. Thanks, thank you once again.